Oh, hi, good evening and welcome to the 6 o'clock show.
He knows we start at 6. We're here to banish those Monday blues with some great guests and delicious food. Joining us tonight for a chat is one of the country's most respected voices. He retired in April after 20 years as a political correspondent. David Davenpower will be here to take a look back on his fascinating career.
We'll also be meeting one of the stars of comedy series Damo and Ivor, who's getting ready to tread the boards. It's comedian Tom O'Mahony.
Over in the kitchen tonight, Graham Hetherich, also known as the Cupcake Bloke, is holding down the fort, and he's joined by our sports star, Sarah O'Donovan. Welcome to you. Graham. My cupcake bloke who never brings me cupcakes. What are we doing tonight?
Tonight, we are going to celebrate Thanksgiving, an early Thanksgiving, by making pecan pie.
I am thankful for you doing this tonight. Definitely.
We're thankful for Graham.
Yes, we are thankful.
Have you ever had his cupcakes?
Yes, I have.
They're beautiful. Sarah, last week was a tough one for us in sport between the World Cup qualifier and the Rugby World Cup bid. But things are looking up. Well, Fiji. Just keep saying Fiji.
He says it like he knows what he's talking about.
Go back again. Right, yep. Watch this. And Sarah, last week was a tough one for us in sport between the World Cup qualifier and the Rugby World Cup bid.
And he's there going, Fiji. What are those things? Fiji, Sarah.
Sure. So Ireland beat Fiji on Saturday. Two tests from two. And we're going to Argentina on Saturday again.
Yes, come on,
Ireland. You've got it covered.
Excellent. Yeah, great stuff. Really right. Now, I'm. Thanks. That's a sports bit.
Well done. Right,
thanks, guys. I've got it covered. Now, I'm a celebrity. Get me out of here. Kicked off. This is something I understand. I'm a celebrity. Kicked off last night, and one contestant taking part is the boxer Amir Khan.
Yes, and he said, Amir Khan has said in a tweet
5 years ago.
Yes, that one thing he would never take part in is. I'm a celebrity, get me out of here. He said that it was a show for has-beens, and now he is, there you go. Yeah. No, it's for has-beens, would you ever go on I'm a Celeb? So he's kind of done a U-turn. He's changed his mind on the show. I wonder why. Why do you think, Brent?
Cha-ching.
You could have something to do with that.
So yeah, we're thinking of U-turns, big changes of mind that you've done. We're looking for your texts and your comments tonight. And big changes of mind for you?
I think for me, mostly it's like on things like clothes, but there is a friend of mine who hated cats, had one of those experiences when they were younger, that a cat, you know, there was a claw and it was bad. And now a cat arrived at his house like 2 years ago. Loves the cat.
It's a cat person.
Won't go on holidays because the cat won't. He doesn't want to put the cat into a cattery and I'd stay around with the cat all the time. So he's changed. Done a U-turn and about face. He loves cats. Raymond, what changed mind in your life?
The biggest one was my wife's change of mind because this is a true story. My wife hated, we worked together when we met initially and she hated me.
She did.
And she says this to everyone. Everyone who listens, she says, she still hates me for totally different reasons now. But she hated me and eventually she got to like me and she eventually married me.
Yeah, but you just, how long did it take you to get her to wear her down a little bit?
5 or 6 years.
Yeah.
No, it wasn't. It was like 6 months.
It wasn't. It was a long time. Oh, no.
Yeah, it wasn't. Yeah, so that's a big U-turn. So U-turns are changes of mind.
Yes.
And that's what we're looking for.
What about you? Have you had a change of heart or a complete U-turn? Send us your stories for a chance to win a coveted 6 o'clock show apron from the T-shirt company as modelled by Graham and Sarah in the kitchen.
Twit-to-woo.
Gorgeous.
Getting in touch is easy. Here's how.
You can get us on WhatsApp 083-360-6060 or text us by sending the word 6 to 53131 followed by your comment.
Pop us an email, 6 o'clock show at tv3.ie, or find 6 o'clock show on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and Snapchat. Now it's time to say hello to our first guest. After setting up Morning Ireland in 1984 and serving as Northern Editor in RTE, he became a household name as their political correspondent for the last 20 years, reporting on landmark events like the signing of the Good Friday Agreement.
He finally hung up the microphone on his retirement in April of this year, but that hasn't kept him out of the spotlight. Please welcome David Davenpower. Hello.
Hi, how are you?
How are you?
And you did hit the headlines recently, and it was simply for saying that you weren't a fan of Conor McGregor.
Look, I'm not mounting a campaign to denigrate Conor McGregor. I was asked a question and I answered it. I mean, there's terrific role models for kids out there in the sporting world and elsewhere. But I happen to think that Conor McGregor really isn't one of them. I think he gets away with a lot of stuff that other sportsmen wouldn't get away with in terms of homophobic remarks and so on. So, yeah, I wouldn't be a fan. But like I say, I'm not going to make it my life's work to try and end his career. I think he's a superb athlete, that has to be said. Mm-hmm. That Mayweather fight really showed him in a different light. But some of his utterances outside the ring, they leave me cold.
Did you get much of a response yourself, like on social media, to your remarks?
I didn't go so far as having to hire bodyguards, but there was social media, there was a couple of remarks. Certainly, my 14-year-old son hasn't spoken to me since.
Right, but, he's a fan, is he?
Well, he's a bit of a fan. Yeah. But I think it was seen as what it was. It was just my own opinion. I mean, who am I?
And fair enough.
Full of many. I'm certainly not going to convert all those Conor McGregor fans here and across the world.
Mm-hmm. Fair enough. In your career, we mentioned, like, you know, you've had a front row seat to some of the biggest events, political and otherwise, events in Irish history, really. And we mentioned the Good Friday Agreement. What was it like being there?
Well, it was cold for a start. Snow at Easter. It's not something that people remember. It actually snowed at Easter time. Yeah. And we were camped out in Stormont buildings, outside Stormont buildings, for months on end. And it went on and on and on. But you knew that very often news stories take you by surprise. But I don't think on this occasion. I think we knew this was a really big event. And there was a kind of a, even for people who had been around the block a couple of times, it was an emotional moment when we actually saw that agreement being signed, because we knew that things were going in the right direction from the early hours. I don't know if you remember that iconic shot of Breege Rogers embracing her SDLP colleagues at 4 a.m, captured through the windows of Stormont buildings. That kind of brought it home to people that things were going to fall into place. But when the deal was actually signed, well, you know, I mean, it was a game changer. And I think that's why what happened later in the year in Omagh was so, so shocking. I mean, that was the other side of the coin. So many people killed in a no-warning or an explosion where the warning had been miscommunicated. I mean, that kind of thing wasn't supposed to happen after the Good Friday Agreement, and it made it all the more tragic when it did.
Yeah, absolutely.
And the political figures that are tied up in this that would have been a part of your life as the Northern editor, we've had recently, because people don't just get engaged anymore, they are getting engaged, and people are not just retiring, they're going to retire, and we've seen that with Gerry Adams on Saturday night announcing his timeline. Do you think it's time for him to go?
Well, I do think it's time for him to go. And I think that he will be seen as one of the great figures of the 20th century.
Do you think so?
I do think so, because he managed to do what nobody else had, which was to wean the mainstream Republican movement off the violence that had been really their staple diet for 150 years. I mean, Republicanism was always associated with violence. And along with John Hume and Seamus Mallon and others, Gerry Adams turned them in a different direction. Now, of course, he didn't turn out to be a particularly adroit politician when he came down here. He seemed out of his depth in Leinster House. But I've always said that Gerry Adams is what you might call a wholesale politician. He's a wholesaler. He goes around behind the scenes, talking to other politicians, doing deals. He's not a retailer, although he does have that star quality when you see him on the streets. There's no doubt about that. People recognise him as a recognition factor. But it's his work behind the scenes that I think he will be remembered for.
And you're talking about sort of his gravitas there. And as you mentioned, you know, he came down south and he's a member of the Dáil. And he's also taken to social media like a duck to water. And you're talking about him being one of the great statesmen. I wonder, will his, you know, his persona on that, like I remember one tweet vividly, you know, I'm in bed, nothing on but the radio. You know, he says this sort of stuff all the time. He's having a bit of crack. Do you think it will take away from him, or do you think it shows a human side
to him? Well, I wouldn't see him as a great statesman. Don't get me wrong. I think his achievement is essentially in recalibrating what the Republican movement was all about. I think those tweets are terribly contrived.
Really?
I think they're an attempt to soften his image, if you will, because he is conscious of the fact that he's seen as somewhat austere. I can't take them seriously at all.
I saw him he was on the set of Fair City. He was auditioning apparently today.
Was he?
Yeah.
Right.
He was looking for work today. That's it.
So you've got to allow a bit of fun.
Yeah, that's it. You've met, well, throughout your career, politically, particularly as political correspondent, you've worked with and dealt with the Taoiseach, several Taoiseach down through the years, from Charlie Haughey to Leo Varadkar now. I mean, we're talking about very different, you know, from Taoiseach to Taoiseach, very different personalities.
Even before that.
Yeah.
When I got into journalism first, the first Taoiseach I dealt with was Jack Lynch, Right. Going back a bit. Yeah. I remember after an interview, it was his practice to come into the office of the director of news in RTE at the time. This would be Sunday afternoon, 2 o'clock, and a bottle of whiskey would be produced. And Jack, of course, as we know, was very fond of Paddy. Right, and he used an expression I'd never heard before, and I thought he was talking about his travel plans going back to Cork. He said, "We'll go as far as Turles," when the bottle of Paddy was produced. But in fact, that was a reference to the map of Ireland on the bottle of Paddy.
Oh, my God. Drink that as far as the line.
In the event, I think we went as far as Bantry, but however.
I think it might as well go.
But, no, I mean, the other Taoiseach, they all had their own particular style. I had a celebrated run-in with Charlie Haughey where he came up to me, shook his fist in his face and used a lot of bad language and ripped off the microphone and stormed out the door. Nowadays, it would be a big media story, but at the time, you just didn't say anything about it.
Really?
But I think the big change I notice down the years is the erosion, to the point that it's not there anymore, of any sense of deference towards politicians, whether they're TDs or ministers or Taoiseachs. I mean, there was an exaggerated sense of importance accorded to them back in the day. But I think the wheel has probably kind of spun a bit too far now. I mean, you have people saying, or certainly during the days of the Celtic Tiger, people saying you didn't need ministers, Michael O'Leary could run the country, it wasn't so hard to run the country.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
And then when the economy crashed, we had people saying it's all their fault, they all should be fired and all the rest of it. But I think politicians, by and large, get a bad press. I think they work very hard. Not very effectively, perhaps, but they work very long hours. Mm. And nowadays, they don't get particularly well remunerated. And, I mean, you might have your qualms about democracy, but when you consider the alternative, it's not a bad system.
Yeah, it's working out all right, Jack, yeah.
And you obviously have been surrounded by politicians all of your career. And there is one time when you were literally surrounded by politicians, and this was at the Fianna Fáil Ordesh in 2009, where you're standing there doing a report. And it was like the zombie apocalypse. They were just staring at you. Like, there you are, there, doing your report.
They call it the zombie, the zombie donut, is it?
That's the zombie donut.
The zombie donut, yes, that's what it is. But
the uncanny thing about it is, I'll tell you a couple of things about it. But when I saw it back, the uncanny thing about it was that they didn't move. They were motionless. apart from John Foley, who fell off his chair and then stood up and faced the wrong way with his back to the camera.
Yeah. Oh, God!
But I didn't know about this zombie donut.
Of course, because you were
well, more than that, immediately I'd finished my thing. I just got off the little stage and I got into my car and I drove home. I think I was actually home before the 9 o'clock news was over. So I had no idea. Yeah. That this had happened until a colleague from the Irish Times, Miriam Lord, rang me the following day saying, "What on earth was going on behind you yesterday?" So I said, "What are you talking about?" And she said, "You won't believe it. You better look at it on the RTE player." So I simply couldn't believe it. But the political parties were mortified. The Fianna Fáil was mortified.
Mm. Yeah.
And of course, RTE blamed me. How did you let that happen? I said, "The floor managers, there's a stage crew. It's not my fault."
Well, it does seem that the Ardèche is always the one where the mortifying stories seem to be coming out for the meeting or the think tanks. Tell us about you're not related to Brian O'Driscoll, are you? You're not blood relatives.
No, there was a thing a couple of years ago that suggested that I looked like, and I personally can't see the resemblance.
Right. Okay.
At all. That's another picture. That's a very, very old picture. That's from the early days of Morning Ireland with David Hanley. God knows how old that is.
So you can't see the similarity between the two of you. People are thinking that, you know, you're his dad sometimes.
I don't know if I like that.
No.
I can't see that. Look, I'm blind to it.
Right. Okay.
Yeah, I mean, I had my Twitter picture is me and Brian O'Driscoll because I acknowledge that, you know, some people think that there is this resemblance, and I've met him a couple of times, and he says, "I don't see it either."
Well, do you know what? When you're out and about, and people are like, "Oh, you were a legend throughout your career," try that you make, take it, David. Don't you worry.
Yes.
Right, over in the kitchen, our cook Graham has a visitor. It's comedian and Damo and Ivor star Tom O'Mahony. Tom, we were talking about David is going into the ring with Conor McGregor now.
Yes, yeah.
You've trained in MMA, is that right?
I did, yeah. Well, I just got the head clattered off me for most of my life. I was one of those kids that needed that. You know, the Irish dancing was never going to sort it out.
Right.
You had to just, You remember that savage child from Mad Max, the fellow with the boomerang?
Yeah.
That was me without the mullet or the tank. That was it.
But four until the age of 22, this is when you practiced it. When you look at Conor McGregor now and the amount of money that's involved in it, are you like, why didn't
No, one bit bothered at all. We're here making zombie donuts. it's great. It's great.
Are we having zombie donuts tonight, Graham, or what are we having?
No, we're not. We're having pecan pie, which is filled with pecans, maple syrup, golden syrup, brown sugar and butter.
This sounds lovely. Go and get the few bits.
Cook along, and then send some into us as well, so we'll have even more. Tom will be here after the break for a chat, and of course, David will be staying put as well.
Don't forget, we want to hear all your change of mind stories, U-turns you've done, and any comments and questions as well for our guests on WhatsApp 083 360 6060. And we'll see you back here in a few minutes.
Welcome back to Monday's 6 o'clock show. We are, of course, live with you until 7 this evening. And on the couch tonight, a familiar figure who graced your TV screens from Leinster House for many years, David Davenpower, is here.
Joining us now is the South Tipperary comedian whose first show at the Edinburgh Fringe Festival in 2012 was a massive smash sellout.
Smash it. He's gone on to star in comedy series Damo and Ivor, and he's getting ready to tread the boards this festive season. Please welcome Tom O'Mahony.
Welcome. How are you?
How's it going?
We know you from Damo and Ivor.
Yeah.
You played a posh Southside Dubliner.
Torquin.
But you're actually a posh Southside Tipperary.
That's where it gets ironic. There is no posh bits in Tipperary. There's no T4.
Okay.
But you are married to a dorky lady from South Dublin. So did she give you grinds?
Essentially, she had to write everything phonetically, like the Ross O'Carroll Kelly books for me. So everything like Wright became Roish, and then there was Morkshing and stuff like that. And after a while, it just became totally sound.
It was fine.
Sound.
It's the sort of thing, actually, that you always hear kind of given out about in RT with reporters, their voices being changed to South Dublin, David. Would it be something that you'd hear inside there they'd be given out about?
Well, I don't think so, no. I mean, Dort speak was something that I think was AA Roadwatch coined Dort speak first, wasn't it? I can't remember the name of the initial presenter, but she was criticised for
the Dort roundabout.
Right, roundabout.
Yes, yeah. Exactly. Yeah.
Yeah.
But I think the RT is fairly flexible about accents. Certainly you hear a couple of ropey ones.
We're not playing games.
He's gone. We're not, and he's happy it. To do it.
So whatever he likes. You got married in April, though.
I did, yeah.
To your dorky wife. What's her name?
Natasha.
I said Natasha then.
She's a mighty woman to put up with me. Fair play to her. Yeah. But we got married in April out in Kildare, which was great.
And how did she coach you to get you that South County Dublin accent?
Oh, quite literally had to write on every single script I had phonetically to do it and just train
And
me
around
to do
the house,
it.
Would she get you to make sure that you never spoke in your real accent? Would you have to?
Well, she does that anyway. I mean, have you heard me? Like, it's not sexy. No, it's not. My accent, it's rough and ready and all the rest of it. So she just basically what she'll do is.
That's a wedding photo.
What's happening in that picture?
Oh, yeah, that was when we got married in 1879. It was.
Sorry, I thought it was April 2017.
Yeah, no, sorry, I never said that. I'm immortal, by the way, and we had to fight. Yeah, I had to fight for her hand in marriage. I lost after 2 hours of fighting, and she just felt sorry for me and just said, look,
okay.
It's not often you see a battle axe in a wedding photo.
No.
You're
going on my list of enemies, David. That was pretty tidy dress.
You're wearing your wedding shoes.
Yeah. I didn't realise I was wearing the wedding shoes out, but now, she pulled a fast one on me the night before. She snuck into my room and stuck a phrase that I use a lot on the back. Do you want to see it?
Yeah.
All right.
Go on.
This is going to look all sorts
of
nice.
Shoes.
So, can that be seen?
Can you see that on the bottom of the shoes?
Can you see it?
Hold it very still for a second.
Oh, this is great.
Resume it.
Are we there?
So can you
there
say you what it says?
How are you, horse?
Yeah, and that's pretty much... I didn't realise I said that a lot to the point that it made my now wife get that printed off and stick it on my shoes, and it won't come off.
Wow, it looks like a custom job, actually.
It does.
Yeah, that was sneaking in while I was just down the corridor. She snuck in, stuck it on, and that was it. So it was, if I did it, I would have stuck it the wrong way around. It just would have been horse hell yeah. It wouldn't have made any sense whatsoever.
And of course, the wedding shoes are the good shoes now.
It's this is it. And why do you think I'm all dressed up for the telly shirt?
I was going to say the telly shoes as well.
Well, would you, would you come by telly shoes?
Would you have found that now, you know, you're married?
Yeah.
Are you still, you know, making the best and most of yourself at all times, dressing dapperly, or are you able to kind of let yourself go a little bit?
Oh, no, I've totally left. I'm pretty much naked from the waist up most days.
Is that it?
Yeah, it's not pretty around my house. I look like hell most of the time. Actually, 98% of the time. When I'm not on telly, that's when I look like hell all the time.
Right.
That's pretty much it.
Well, we mentioned the Edinburgh show, and that's really when things exploded for you, and you've been a very successful comedian ever since. But you were originally worked in construction, is that right? During the good times?
They were great times.
Were they?
Oh, they were... I tell you, I would have bought 11 houses while you were talking to David. I became an expert skier. A man from Tipperary. Expert skier. It was ridiculous, but great.
That was skiing or snowboarding?
You give it to me, I would have been able to do it anyway, regardless.
So that's when you were a civil engineer during the boom, working on construction sites. So, insider information from back in the day. Is the boom back?
The boom is back. The two Johnnies brought out a song. The boom is back. I know people are counting cranes, which is the weirdest thing I've ever heard of in my life. That's the worst hobby. People are going, I saw another crane today. But no, you can spot it. It's back. It's back because the pointless crap food is back on menus. There was a good 7 years we had nothing but boiled and roasted stuff. Stuff that the Irish digestion system could deal with. And then all of a sudden, things like couscous are back on menu.
Yeah, there you go.
Am I right?
With chia seeds on Friday night, I'm telling you, the boom is back.
Nobody likes couscous. Nobody likes it.
It's kind of a
David,
rice.
Do you like couscous?
I do like couscous.
There we go!
You'll only eat it. I bet you've never sat down and went, you know what I'd murder? A big bowl of couscous would be... Because you know what? Couscous is the crumbs of something that might have been nice one time. That's what couscous is.
It's what you eat when there's no rice in the house.
That's it. How pretentious does a food have to get to name itself twice? you've never eaten cabbage. You know what I mean?
We haven't even started talking about quinoa.
Quinoa. That'll tell you what a South Dublin wife will teach you. I was calling it quinoa for years. She went, quinoa?
She sorted you out.
I thought it was a disease.
Is that it?
you've got a busy run up to Christmas between now and Christmas. Oh, and after, the panto's on.
Yeah. It's crazy. Like, the gigging, it always picks up this time of year. Tonight I'm in Whelan's for the Pop Cherry, but all week then I'm in London doing gigs because I have my own big show at the Museum of Comedy next Saturday night, so if any diaspora are watching, send them along.
Wow.
And then straight back Monday morning, we start rehearsals for the panto Cinderella, the UCH panto, which will be down in Limerick. And there's a gang of us from Samantha Mumba, Dale Cronin, myself, Richie Hayes, Leanne Moore, and a bunch of people who are really good at panto, and this guy.
And you!
That's what I'm talking about.
Oh, yes, you are. I did it! You have to get used to it.
Who are you in?
I'm playing Dandini. So if anybody wants to tell me who he is, last year, myself and Karen Spain they brought us on, and you get to see all these unbelievably professional people who could sing, dance, look good, and act. And we're standing there going, we've jokes, if anybody
wants to sing about
it, that's it. So apparently I turfed out enough that they want me back this year. So.
It worked. Well, 2 years in a row. Well done, Tom.
Right, well, earlier, that's tonight in Whelan's as well, by the way. Now, earlier on, we were chatting about the boxer Amir Khan. He's now appearing on I'm a Celeb, despite tweeting it's for has-beens a few years ago. He was on Twitter saying, I'd never go on that show for has-beens. He's on it now. So it's kind of awkward. So we're talking about U-turns and big changes of mind in your life.
Over in the kitchen, we've got our cook, Graham, and our sports guru, Sarah. They've been keeping an eye on your comments for us. So, Sarah, hello to you in the kitchen.
Good evening.
Do you have something for us there?
I do. Danielle Gaffney. So she was in fifth year. She did work experience in hairdressing. She absolutely hated it, completely turned off. And as of September, she's starting a hairdressing course.
Hey!
Good U-turn. That's all good. So we're going to have more of those in just a little while. And Graham is going to be letting us in on his pecan pie recipe later on in the show. And Sarah will be here to talk about all things sports just after this break.
And of course, David and Tom will be sticking around for more chats too. We'll see you after this. Welcome back. We've been chatting to journalist David Davenpower and Damon Ivor star Tom O'Mahony already tonight.
And with us now is a woman whose eye it is always on the prize. Hello, please, to Sarah O'Donovan. Hello.
Excuse me.
So we're starting this evening with rugby, something that we seem to be able to win at, which is quite nice.
Well, after the disappointment of last week, it was so lovely to go out and beat a team on Saturday.
Yeah.
Now, we didn't do it that comprehensively. It was 23-20.
So this is Ireland-Fiji on
Indeed.
Saturday. Yeah.
Yes, so it's the second test. The Rugby World Cup is coming up in 2019. And Joe Schmidt has said 19 games to find his best squad for 2019. And on Saturday, he obviously had three tries from Darren Sweetnam, Jack Conan, Dave Kearney, and then two late penalties from Ian Keatley. But there was 13 changes from the South Africa game the week before. So Joe Schmidt really is looking at everybody for that World Cup squad for 2019, and he's starting early.
And it seems kind of nice because Ian Keatley, he had such a bad run of it, like in Munster. He was getting destroyed by the fans kind of like a couple of years ago.
Yeah.
This year, the pressure doesn't seem to be there, and he seems to be performing so much better.
Well, he's bedded into the role. Obviously, there was big shoes to fill, and people weren't happy with how quickly he was coming on. But this season, he's the guy who everyone has to go to, and he's stepping up. So.
Yeah, because Tyler Blaindell, I suppose, when he's there, he just seems he's got a bit more room.
Yes. We're really excited about Ireland and the way they're playing at the moment. And obviously, Saturday is the big game against Argentina. Now, if you remember, Ireland lost to Argentina in the World Cup quarterfinal. Will it be revenge? There'll only be seven players playing from that team that lost in Cardiff. But certainly, I think all of the Irish players will be looking to put in a performance and make sure that Argentina feel it.
And with this sort of a thing, Tom, we know that this is just like David, this is the autumn internationals. It's friendly. We're looking towards the Six Nations. But is it important for a matter of pride with everything that's been going on, not getting the World Cup, all that kind of stuff?
Absolutely.
They want to go out and get it.
Absolutely. Well, like you were saying, he's trying to rack up a serious team because last time the reason why we lost Argentina is because lads were just dropping like flies and we didn't have backup anywhere. So at least now you're finding the likes of Andrew Conway and lads who can actually, you know, they'll be able to slot in no problem. Zeebo went out the gate and they thought we were done. Conway last weekend.
Yeah, it was quite interesting, actually, wasn't it? Because I'd say Zeebs is not happy about that.
Well, not happy to the point where he tweeted during the week, Simon Zeebo, giving away his Ireland gear.
Oh, dear.
Yeah, gave away two bags of Ireland gear and the jersey that he wore against New Zealand and said, Christmas is coming early. So I think that was a barbed tweet towards management decisions.
There you go. That's interesting.
Dude!
The international rules. We were having an argument in the office about the scoring system for this. This was goals only, am I right?
No. The international rules had points and goals.
Points
the
and goals.
Fenway Classic that we'll be talking about.
That's
after
the other one. Right,
goals.
Okay, fine. Yes. So explain this one to me then.
International rules. So Ireland versus Australia. It was the second test and you won it on aggregate. So Australia were up by 13 points the first day and Ireland had to win obviously by more than 10 to obviously win the series.
Okay.
You're saying obviously a lot to Ray. Let's not just say that everything is obvious.
Sorry, assume you're talking to a three-year-old girl.
Three-year-old girl.
Three-year-old. So we have, it's good. The second test has happened. We won.
No, we didn't.
Oh, did we not win? Oh, we didn't win! I thought we did!
Oh. Yeah, okay, team, we'll get back on track here.
She spent the last, 2 hours laughing at me about my ineptitude when it comes to sport, and now she drops that clanger. Go on, tweet it now. You can send your 0833-60-60-60s in now.
So, look, it was all going very well for Ireland.
We didn't win.
No, we didn't win. We lost the series, and we lost two games. I think... I think the Australians were much cleverer on the ball, right? What happened was Ireland's new players hadn't played the game before and they were schooled. They were schooled in the system. They tried to play Gaelic football and Australia weren't playing Gaelic football. So you had a very funny situation in third quarter where Ireland were trying to block the ball by doing it Gaelic football style.
Yeah.
And the Aussies were just coming in and ramming lads down onto the ground.
Yeah, okay.
So the Irish lads didn't really understand the rules. And Joe McKiernan, the manager, came out and said it didn't feel to him like they were playing by the system that the rule book had been introduced 2 weeks ago. So he certainly wasn't impressed by it.
People have had issue with it as well, kind of saying, what's the point of it? Mark O'Shea is like, what's the point of international rules?
It was a funny one because Ciarán Whelan, who was talking about it after on RT Sport, said the reason why it's there at all is because the Australians need, for grant purposes, to have an international aspect to their game. So it sounds like there's a brown envelope and one lad's having giving the other lad a favour to go down to Australia. Like, it's 3 weeks and none of the Dublin guys played in it.
Yeah.
You know? Now, for a calendar that's so compacted already, it seems ridiculous that players would have to commit so far out. So Dick Clerkin, from former Monaghan footballer, was giving stick to the Dublin guys, saying that there should have been Dublin players playing. And then All-Star James McCarthy tweeted him and said, you should have done your research. And then Jack McCaffrey came out to say that while some of the Dublin players were asked, not all of them were asked, that some of them would have loved the opportunity to go. So there seems to be miscommunication there.
But how much interest is there in the international rules now?
Well, look, there was 30,000...
Waning, I would say.
It's waning, but there was 30,000 people at the game in Perth. So there's that element of Irish people living that far away who still have such an interest in the GAA that they wanted to support.
But
they're the same in Adelaide.
But for us, they're putting it on at a time. It was on at 4:45 in the morning. You know, you had Michael Lester inside in the studio and you're kind of going, could they not have put it on in a different venue so that it would have been more conducive for us watching it at home either, you know?
All right, yeah, fair enough. Let's start at the hurling once and for all. Boston, goals only.
Right.
Fenway.
So the Fenway Classic was on Sunday, and actually some of the Dublin footballers who could have been in Australia were actually in Boston instead.
Right.
And the Fenway Classic is an 11-a-side game with goals only, as you so pointed out.
Right.
The goalkeeper is pretty much obsolete because it's a massive goal that they can't really take any scores or save any scores in. And the ball is going up and down the field at a rate of knots.
Mm-hmm. And the pitch is very small.
Well, it's a baseball pitch.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So it takes out all the best elements of hurling, to my mind.
Okay.
And there was 27 points scored by Peter Duggan from Clare. And Clare ended up winning it. 27 points is 9 goals. So you can imagine the ferocity of the game going up and down the field. There was a schmozzle between Dublin and Galway at the start, obviously, to get spirits going. And at the end of it, I don't know how successful it was to show people the skill of the game. By comparison, in Thurles, there was a rip-roaring game that took place in the Munster hurling final.
Typically.
Yes. There was only 3,000 people at it. But then if you look at TG4 on Sunday morning, there was over 250,000 people tuned in to TG4 to watch the Fenway Classic.
There you are.
Okay.
So, I don't know.
Is that done for grant purposes as well?
Was it done for grant purposes? I don't know.
Well, no, it's there as well, and it's a tourism thing as well to highlight the game and all that kind of thing that goes with it.
Because we're not, like, we have a brilliant game. I don't think we needed to condense it into an 11-a-side.
Except for when Sarah's invited to play next year.
Let's go. Sarah, thanks a million.
After the break, I'm going to be relocating to the Sixth Kitchen with David and Tom, where the cupcake bloke will be walking us through his pecan pie recipe.
Now, there's something I understand.
Yes.
I'll be reading more of your comments and questions, so keep them coming to us on WhatsApp, 0833 60 60 60. But before all that, here's your chance to win tickets to a special event and a hotel stay.
All this week on the 6 o'clock show, we've teamed up with Dublin Zoo, who've launched a brand new magical nighttime spectacular event called Wild Lights. This promises to be an unforgettable experience this festive season, and we want to send a lucky family along to the event, including an overnight stay in the Maldron Hotel Dublin Airport with breakfast. Open now and running until the 7th of January, Wild Lights features giant colourful lanterns and illuminated animal sculptures, all inspired by wildlife. Tickets are on sale now at dublinzoo.ie. If you would love to win this fabulous prize, just answer the following question. What is a group of lions called? A, a herd, or B, a pride? Just call 1550 999 091 or text WILD to 57199 to enter. Best of luck.
Welcome back. We're live with you until 7 tonight. And with me here in the kitchen, I have got journalist David Davenpower and comedian Tom O'Mahony. Graham is in charge of the kitchen this evening. So remind us, what are we making?
So we're making pecan pie.
Lovely.
So Thanksgiving is on Thursday. Very traditional dessert for Thanksgiving.
For Americans.
For Americans.
For Americans, yes. Don't tell me that this is a new thing we have in Ireland now, because I'm not ready for this.
No, we're just coping with Black Friday.
Okay, that's fine. No, don't bring that up. Do you get involved in Black Friday?
I don't know what it is. Sorry,
okay, that's fine. It's shopping.
Well, no.
Okay, no. It's Graham. Graham's going to be doing this. So how do we start?
So we start off with shortbread, or sweet shortcrust pastry is the base of the actual tart. Now, I've said in the recipe just to use shop-bought pastry. I've... I know, yes. It's easy. When you're doing work like this, you want bacon to be quick and easy.
If you're going to bake it...
Now, I have made it, and if anybody wants the recipe, I'll put it up on my Facebook page, but you can buy it. It's just as good.
Okay.
So what I mainly want to talk about...
You're very forgiving. Well done.
But what I mainly want to do is talk about blind baking. Because you have to blind bake the tart tin first, okay?
So this is what we always hear on the bake-off.
Exactly.
We're always hearing about blind baking on the bake-off. So
I've rolled up my pastry to the size of the tin. And I'm just laying it over. Okay? Oh,
that's good.
Okay.
That's good already.
It was excellent work there.
Okay. So that's your pastry going in. Mm-hmm. To blind bake it, you need to line it. A lot of recipes call for baking beans, which are like these little ceramic beans that you have to especially buy.
Now, these seemed like things, they just came into my life when I started watching Bake Off. Yeah. I had never seen my mother or anyone I never know to
need
them.
You don't need them. Right. Right? So to... I'm leaving the pastry at the end, when after it's baked, I trim off the pastry then.
Yeah.
And that stops the shrinkage.
Okay.
So I have a little bit of baking pattern here, which I'm actually crumpling up. Okay?
So you're not lining it?
Oh, I am going to line it.
By
crumpling it, you've softened it.
Yeah.
And it fits into all the edges.
Oh, God,
you're like a wizard.
So much.
Last week, it is just a fantastic tip.
So that, so you're a baker?
Cooker.
You're a cooker, okay. But when it comes to stuff like this, who told you this last week?
I don't know. The internet, presumably.
Right.
I mean, when you're lining any kind of baking tray, you're trying to get the paper down or in around the corner. It's a nightmare.
Crumple it up.
Scrunch it up. That's the end of your problem.
And it's done.
And here I have rice.
Yes.
So this is rice that I've been using for blind baking for about 6 months.
Oh, great.
And I just reuse the rice all the time.
So that just goes into the oven?
And it's spread it, yep. Put it in like that. It keeps it down. So the blind baking cooks the pastry at the bottom.
Yeah.
So it does. And yes, that goes into the oven. So for 15 minutes like that. So that's the
egg. Why is it called blind baking? Because you're not looking at it, you're just giving it an average thing? What is it?
I don't actually know where blind is, but it's just to bake the actual pastry. So you don't get a soggy bottom.
I definitely thought it was going to be way more dangerous.
Did you? Yeah. We're all right.
So it's 15 minutes like that, then you take out the rice and the paper, and then another 15 minutes, and you end up with something like this.
So you take out the rice and paper, you put it back into
back
the oven again.
Back to get a nice colour on it.
Okay, and as you said, you have been reusing your rice for about 6 months now.
Yeah.
Grand. So, all good.
So that's our pastry case ready. It needs to cool before you put in the filling that we're going to bake a second time.
So let it stand for a while.
Yeah, exactly. So it's cool there.
Yeah, okay.
So in here I have creamed together sugar and butter. So it's 75 grams of butter and 100 grams of golden caster sugar. Yeah. And into it we add 3 beaten eggs.
Yes, okay. And if anyone's looking for this recipe, it's on tv3.ie/6eats. You can check it out there. If you want it for this weekend. So
yes, and that's what goes into that. So that's your base for it.
Yeah.
Also what goes into it is all the gooey stuff starts now. 175 grams of golden syrup.
Right.
Righto.
Yes.
Ooh, I like it already.
Like, isn't it?
Can we go back? So you say you beat the eggs.
The eggs were beaten.
Not emotionally.
No.
Not emotionally. Right.
It's okay. We treat them all with respect here. We treat the eggs with respect.
So it's 175 grams of the golden syrup and 175 grams of maple syrup.
Holy, do you need them both?
Yes.
Just before you run a marathon.
Maple and maple work so well together. Mm. Too much maple and it's too strong.
Yeah, okay.
So that's why I use both, just to get the flavour in there.
Right, okay. Yeah. These are probably two. Golden syrup, yes, I've had. I'm not too sure if I've ever had.
And you know with me, with my vanilla bean paste, I love this stuff. This is like concentrated vanilla beans.
Oh, wow.
And that just
never seen that.
Half a teaspoon. Amazing stuff. Really, really strong. Just vanilla beans.
That has fancy shop written all over it.
It does, doesn't it?
You're not done source.
Like I said, fancy shop. All over it.
Fancy shop, you know? All good.
So, we continue just to mix this for a second. It will look like it's kind of split, but that's absolutely fine.
Okay, so if this is what's happening, don't freak out.
Don't freak out, that is absolutely fine.
Okay.
And then into that, we have 300 grams of pecan nuts. Now, pecan nuts are quite expensive. It can be, you could use a mixture of walnuts, chopped almonds and pecan nuts to make it slightly less
diluted a little bit.
Exactly.
Now, I have eaten a few of those, but it's fine, we're good, right?
We're absolutely fine.
I didn't know that you needed them all for the recipe, but look
at you go. They all go in there, yeah. Absolutely, okay.
It's fine, I've got a pocket full of them.
We just thought they were for the guests as we walked in. Oh, look, it's like a mint.
So then this all goes into the tin.
Wow.
And spread it out.
You don't put a top on the pie, no?
Nope.
So with, again, as you said, dilute if you want with whatever ones that you actually want, because they can be just little bit expensive.
It looks horribly separated, but that's all
no,
right.
No, it is absolutely fine. It is, because it's like the origins of it. I was doing a bit of research about it. So it's either coming from European, like some sort of Europeans going over to England. So they think the origin is like a treacle tart.
Yeah.
Or some of the French coming over with some sort of a tart into New Orleans. Pecan nuts are native to the southern states of America. Mm. So that's where they found all these pecan nuts. So it's like a treacle tart that's been brought over and added with nuts into it.
Okay. So earlier on when you were doing it, and David knows these things, I do not know these things. He's like, oh, bit, but you're fine.
That is absolutely
fine. That's what it's meant to
that's
be doing.
Absolutely fine. So that goes into the oven at 200 degrees for 10 minutes.
10 minutes.
Yeah.
That's
then, no. And then you turn it down to 160 degrees.
Yeah.
For another 30 minutes.
All right. Okay. So yeah. You need 40 minutes baking time.
Yes.
And you end up with a pecan pie.
Something like this. Good. Exactly.
Is this okay? This is not.
I love. I do love how David totally called him. That looks. That looks terrible. How's this going to pan out?
I'm sitting there going, oh no.
If it pans out like that, there's no problem.
That is absolutely delicious.
So that is what you had. So you can see.
No, you're fine. Just give it a.
That's you. Just want to take that one, Tom. Is that it?
So you can see the kind of treacly pie element to it.
Oh, good lord.
At the bottom.
It smells delicious.
Oops,
it smells so delicious. And it is one of those things, I suppose, for Americans. That's the first time I would have ever heard of it, like an American sitcom.
Look who it is.
Yes.
Look who it is.
Don't mind me.
There's a little bit,
which is a little bit, even a little more.
Is that all that it is?
But like, don't mind me.
It is a special treat, so you have to have some cream on the side.
Course.
Listen, I don't think...
Humphrey sheep is a lamb, as they say.
You don't seem to be having an issue with any of this. You're like, let's go.
Come on.
Looks fab, Graham. We were talking about U-turns, big changes of mind that you've made. It was your man on I'm a Celeb. He did a big U-turn. He said he'd never go on it. Amir Khan, the boxer.
Yes, he's a boxer, yeah.
He said he'd never go on it. He tweeted 5 years ago saying, I'd never go on it, it's for losers. And of course, he's on it now. We're looking for your U-turns to get into win the apron tonight. Mark in Dublin says, when I was doing my leaving cert, I was in higher level maths, you big show off. Despite everyone telling me to drop, I was determined to stick to my guns, but when I got my mock result of 20%, I had to eat my words and drop to ordinary level. Safe to say, I was thankful I did in the end, even then I barely passed. Thank you for your message. David McKenna, when I was 13, I was never allowed to play GAA, as the coach said that none of my family were involved in it. What kind of a weird...
What?
Because none of my family were involved in it.
It does happen. I'm afraid that does happen.
That's mad.
It's like the mafia. You can't just join. Yeah. I know you're not like the mafia, GAA. I know you're not.
Horses, head and sofas, the whole lot.
Madness.
The whole lot. I took up hurling in my 50s with Carrick Hurling in County Leitrim. I'm still rubbish, but I'm loving it now. Wow, there you go.
Leitrim is fine.
Linda and Claire are on as well. I was such a tomboy when I was younger. I was completely against handbags and jewellery as I felt they were such old woman things and I could just use my pockets. But you're now, I can't leave the house without my handbag. Linda, you and me both, babes. That's true.
Do you want to try some of this? Because it is...
I'm on a diet thing
at the moment.
I am on a...
This is for your work.
Go on, use
this is a work thing.
This is for your work.
It looks absolutely incredible.
Tom O'Mahony, we have to remember... You were in Whelan's tonight,
in Dublin. Next, if anybody knows of anybody in London, I'm in the Museum of Comedy in the Leicester Square Theatre next Saturday.
Yes,
night.
And then in Limerick, you will be dressing up
as Dandini.
Dandini in Cinderella.
Yep.
From the 18th of December until January the 7th.
God, is it going that long?
It is going that long, my friend. Did you know this?
And you've signed it. You've signed the contract.
He's done it.
Great. And to talk about U-turns.
David Tavenbauer, what's next? I'm just wondering, because you don't seem like that. Is it a book?
Got to do a book.
Well, I'm taking
it Cinderella with me.
I thought you were going to ask me about U-turns. I was going to say 6 months ago I swore I'd never appear on television again.
Yay!
He said, I'm never going on the
show. And now he's saying, I'm never coming on the show.
I'm not the kind of guy to put my feet up. So I've got a couple of ideas. But as I say, I took 6 months off. I'm putting my toe back in the water now. And we'll wait and see what 2018 turns up. But I don't really play a lot of golf and I don't have a huge number of hobbies. So it will be, I will be doing
a word processor. We'll sort you out a word processor.
But he has to do something for his fans. Because you know that there is a thing that's called Wig Watch that's on boards that people think that you wear a wig.
You're giving me an idea now. I mean, I could run to a range of hair products.
That's what it is.
I, I'm
need to know all about it. It's amazing.
It is amazing.
Yeah, we're out of time, unfortunately.
It's all real.
We've got to go. Yes. A big thank you to all of our lovely guests. To David Davenpower, to Tom O'Mahony, Sarah Donovan, and of course, Graham, for feeding us.
Yes, myself and Martin will be back here at the usual time tomorrow when we'll be joined by crime novelist Sinead Crowley and singer-songwriter Stephanie Rainey. They're going to be here.
We're out of here. Have a great weekend. Bye for now.
Evening, not weekend. It's Monday.